of course, as an independent contractor, I work for a financial services. So you know a lot about me already, so I'm going to jump straight in. So I'm going to keep it at half an hour. Okay, talking about Spring Framework. Forget about the first line, the framework, the requirements you need to create. What I'm going to talk about basically is the version 1, version 2, and 2.1, which I guess you're all here and interested in what's coming in the latest version of Spring. JSR 3.1.6, I'll explain that, but you might really know about that already. I can see a few people on their heads. The main part, I guess the people who've never programmed the Spring Framework, I'm going to give you some words and wisdom from my development experience at VX Investment Banks in London to summarise this. So what is Spring? How many of you know the difference between a managed framework and an unmanaged framework? Well, a managed framework is a framework like Spring that manages your code for you in a container. And an unmanaged framework doesn't. Spring is managed. It's a managed framework that compares, takes care of your jobs. So it has methods for initialization, it injects dependencies into your service, into your components, and dare I say it, if you use a prototype version of Spring beans, those beans will be destroyed. Well, let's hope for the best. Okay, the dependency injection tends to work with Java beans and interfaces. And Spring has a load of utilities, libraries, APIs. So this is the picture of Spring version 1. The idea that what Johnson has is to simplify JTB development. Of course, you already know that Spring has great data access. It already has an AOP, elastic orientated programming, a dynamic version, not the static variety from AspGen. It has a few other classes. And libraries, for example, remoting is exceptional. You can use the JDK scheduler or call scheduler to make asynchronous calls. Big benefit with the Spring XML file is the declarative syntax for transactions. And of course, Spring also supports the web container. We have a competing framework to Struts called Spring MVC. So Spring MVC is part of the Spring core set libraries. So that's the simplistic version 1, which we know from about a couple of years ago now. Now on to version 2. We now have AspectJ library support, so now you can use point cuts if you write, you can use expressions from that. Look like AspectJ pointcuts. I'll explain that later on. The data access is being expanded. Spring has an EJ lean access, message driven lean access, and also has non traditional J2B access, which will be your JBC, your iBATIS, your Hibernate. What are the typical things that you could use outside of container? Java 5 is also new. There's support for annotations, which is the biggest improvement in the Spring container. The other bits involved, I admit to not knowing so well. Portlets. I suppose if anybody's done any WebLogic portlet server, probably could explain. XML namespaces. How many of you have programmed a lot of Spring XML files? A and looks at the transactions side of setting up things that work across transactions. Spring has a way of allowing framework, I suppose, third-party Spring engineers to specify an XML extension through XML namespace, and I'll point that out later on. As Scott Phil pointed out, there is extensions for the latest scripting languages which come out JDK 5, and of course there's also, if you've been programming with Spring MVC, like I have 4 months at the beginning of the year, you'll see some tablets for Spring MVC libraries. So, I've got a bit of a few here. On to Spring 201. Now, a lot of it is laid out now. So, as the J integration from the Spring 1 conference was a big boon. Will be a big boon if you're programming with Raspberry J. You will be able to use a load time weaver, an LWT, to get Raspberry J aspects into a Spring framework application. Now, familiar data access. Here I'm talking about typical JBs and JMS and things that you all know in the J2B container. But if you have, for example, to work with a mainframe, then you might be willing to look at the Java Connection architecture. JCA support 1.5 is now brand new in Spring. And also something very esoteric, which is LDAP support. So if you know about JDBC templates and you could get your head around JMS templates, well, an LDAP template surprisingly looks very familiar, and you can add a guest LDAP callback executor to get information from LDAP. Now, LDAP is probably less important for most of us unless we are working with human resources, 1,000, 10,000 employees, or dare I say 50,000 employees. And I still would like to do a suggestion. Ajax from all employees in the company. Moving swiftly. One of the most confusing things that I think for 2.1 is the annotation driven injection. There are a lot of annotations. There's a lot more annotation support in 2.1, which especially related to JSR 2.0. Which means that your annotations, you can, it's almost if you've come across EJB3 work, where you have post-create and pre-destroy, or is that the other way around? You get a similar sort of thing in JSR 2.0. There's componentization screen as well, which allows you to, instead of writing XML, write annotations and drop them on sort of mark, well, effectively annotate your service being without writing in the XML. A new at auto-wired annotation that will wire those components together. And forgetting one thing, is an at component annotation, which will specify that job will be should be treated as a Spring being. And so, of course, that brings together componentization. So, one of the new things that we find is the configuration file, which I guess will tie into Phil's work. Right shift will probably be a lot of annotation. Well, there will be a component scanning. There is a component scanning annotation. Research is for the application context associated with your application. And Spring Security, rebranded ACG, or ACG Security. one more thing. If you are going to write threat ruling and you want to execute arbitrary tasks at certain interviews, of course you can always do quartz or JDK timer. Those of you who know concurrent programming in Java Flow, there's an abstract, an abstraction around the execution that you write. That's really nice. So, the goals of Spring 2.0, and also the race for it, is of course, you know, to be backwards compatible with version 1, there's annotations, transactions, to simplify the experience with Java 5, that version recognizes Java 5. I've covered the XML namespaces. Of course, there's you do a lot of publishing with JMS, you can also write Spring abstractions, regardless if you use an application server or not an application server. So that might be useful too. Okay. Right, in 2.1, I think OSGI would be the biggest brand in that. Now, Constantine Lowe, I think I got that right for Romanian speakers in the audience, is modularizing every single Spring jar file. So, what in this 2.1 download, which I hopefully will be released as a main download, if you get your favorite wins on Zipper 2, and actually examine some of those files you're seeing. Some nice bits in the meta, under the meta info. There will be an extended OSGI XML namespace, which will allow you to say, right, this bean is an OSGI module or bean, so that can be exported and therefore imported by other OSGI modules. So I've already covered the Spring backends. Oh yes, enhanced JPS, I missed that out in the diagram. So Java Persistent Architecture, for those who don't know about the acronym. Now, I kind of want to believe it, but the Spring developers and engineers are talking about writing an abstraction for criteria fields and also user types. So, Hibernate users and developers will probably be, how are they managing to do that when certain other JPA providers don't support criteria? So we're seeing. So there'll be a way to do that. But of course there's a JPA template. So now, what I wanted to do here is I'll do a little short discussion. So I'm going to rush that through actually. Chris Richardson, I don't know if you've read his book, Paul Jones in Action, he was at the Spring 1 conference. And I think Phil got the information on that, or that mention of that you could be locked into Spring. Did you go to that talk?
I did
actually. Yeah, no, well, someone did. It might have been Marco Van Eden, I apologize. I think we're 5 years away, considering that Spring interface to 21 is like 10 million.
I thought you said Spring would no longer be around.
Yeah, maybe that was it. But everything does get replaced. And now, it's kind of a reversal of what's going on. Everybody, when they learned Java, knew about JDBC or programmed, they went to a course. I think we're kind of doing things perhaps the other way around, because not many of us know about OSGI unless they're well tuned in and want that actual requirement. So it's a possibility that Spring can obscure OSGI. 3.16, JSR 3.16 is the new JSR Java specification release number for Java EE6. Remember, we've only recently got application service Java being certified. And it would let Logic serve 10 people in your audience. Unless you're using Cast, which I've done a little bit of. And of course, there's a modularization coming with Java being 6, which will mean that they're talking about adding something called a profile, which kind of makes sense. So, in a nutshell, the problem with Java EE or JWEE, you take an EAR, that field created in WebLogic, and I give it to Tatiana, yeah? And she's working on IBM Webster application. Something wrong with that module, I can't just give her the EAR and drop that into applications without actually recompiling source and then setting up deployment descriptors. So the only thing that actually will work is all files. And so Java EE 6 is about setting up a standard profile. And maybe the deployment descriptor helm, WebLogic, VA, XMI files, XMI files, might go away in this new way, and it's very early days. With OSGI, it's a standard that exists in specification long before the recent interest in JSR, even the JSP. So 277 is a Java module system that talks about simple packages and modularization of runtimes to OSGI. And 294 is the dynamic components of that specification. So, unless you are an OpenJDK engineer, you probably won't know much about it, but I believe there's a pre-release specification which takes about 68 megabytes in size, and you can compile it over a couple of over the weekend to see what. And it looks promising with journal files and all this. Right, for an architect, which some of us are, it represents a new opportunity. Now, the business might say, look, can you give me a new rules engine on an application server? My trays are fading. And it might be a way. And Phil's ideas are perfectly valid. At runtime, it might be very costly. You know, intensive, it might be very costly to bring down the whole application server to put in a new fixed income module that would price a bond trade or any sort of derivative trade. So, the sort of thing writing modules, I think, will become important. Now, modules is different from profiles. Now, we know that walls work, so this is where Java EE 6 and Bill Shannon, who's the spec lead, I think has got it right. We should concentrate on the web profile, and then we can do some, I suppose, nutty things that we might have headless application servers with no web container in it at all. And then your miners will indeed be in. So, what about 15 minutes? So for people who don't know much about Spring Framework, on this thing here, this is the new way of defining your XML, your namespace. Everything in Spring is now a schema and a namespace. So your beans XML element must define that if you want to use some of these new features. What I'm going to talk about is the transaction manager, how we define the transaction manager. The first thing we need is the transaction manager itself, yeah? And simple bean factory, bean definition there. Using hibernate for transaction manager. The next bit is to define some advice. These are the operations that we are going to apply to any transactions, any classes that can get involved in transaction management. So if you know your JTE, you should be able to recognize that you can have redundant transactions. By default, and I'm not showing it here, you can, I suppose, almost annotate from XML the methods you would like to be involved in transactions. And they will be required, they will be, propagation will be required. So, any questions? No. So the next bit is the AOP side of it, and again we have our AOP XML namespace, and we're defining point cut. We have this bit, we're calling the point cut a given ID, project service operation, and this bit is aspect J, yes, aspect J expression. So what this bit says is I want to, for this package website tracker dot service, any class in here and any method with any type of arguments which return any type of arguments which include white. So basically it will apply a transaction to that, to classes inside and methods inside website tracker service. And of course the reference here is back to its. Of course, you can have more than one point cut for. You might have a fixing constraint service or other bits and pieces of what's happening, then to feed you something else. Okay. If you asked about hyperlinked, so I'm going to ask you a question about if you're about hyperlinked.
Well, let's ask about AOP. When you say it's aspect J, it's using aspect J, it's using aspect J point cut definition.
I think it is actually, yes.
Is it using Spring AOP to the actual continuum, the AOP? Is that the device to use an SPJ?
Yes, it's using the runtime, I understand, which is included. But I'll get everything from AOP. Just give me Spring, I'm pulling what you like, so I can't really tell you exactly that, but I would imagine. Question mark.
Have you tried what you were mentioning before, load time weaving?
No, I haven't. I have not. Myself personally, I've not used load time.
The load time, you definitely need to use the SFJ.
Yeah.
Because that's, I mean, Spring AFPs,
yeah.
Yeah. That's that configurable work on the internet. That's that configurable
work. That components, yeah.
That's it.
Yeah, so if you want to use a long-term lever, then you'll be using the aspect J in your Java. You're doing all sorts of modules, or idioms, I should say, modules. Securitization.
Excuse me, I left the lever on the roads, I'll get to my day. Thanks everybody.
Yeah.
I'll see you soon.
Cool. Just for the AOP. Why would you not use SFJ?
Well, it depends on the project. It has a sponsor contract, and you don't have to say so.
Maybe if you had a choice, you could just give me SFJ.
Yes, if you want. I would use it if I want to, and this is personal, I want to be more control of AOP than what I was given with Spring. I wanted, for example, field injection, interception in actual field. Suppose I have closed source, third party jar files. I can't really do anything about that. I'm sure it's not using Aspect J or any Weaver itself. I could potentially, you know, write an Aspect J that intercepts and does something around. Field some third party line if I don't have to sort where. Okay, so where was I? Hibernate. I suppose this is all rudimentary here. I'm set up your mapping resources and say where your hibernate mapping files are. This is and the hibernate properties, say what your dialect is, Oracle, dialect, Sybase. What you actually need a data source, and data source is not here. It could be the JTA coming from an application server. Now this guy is interesting. If you're doing a lot of tiering, or where you put the application is divided in, say, runs in Tomcat, and then communicates with an application server somewhere else, and then you might run across a unique object identity exceptions where someone's modified the DTO, which also maps your domain object on the client side, and you send that information back across the wire to the presentation tier, and that provides it back to the application server. And then you have the problem of merging everything back, and you perhaps could do it manually across that. Testing that one field has changed and it's not the same, then that field has changed. Another way to do it is perhaps always infer that you use an ID transfer merge event listener, which makes sure that when detached objects are merged, that your IDs are actually reflected back into the client object graph. Doesn't quite make sense unless you do have that an enterprise application. Hibernate template is useful. Sometimes you don't want to inject the Hibernate template into a DAO. You just want to do it. You might want to put it into a service. So that's quite useful to have that lying around. I've chosen a simple IDE name, but you might, in a proper real world application, we have different template for different databases and whatnot for big enterprise applications. So here I am injecting the Hibernate template into my service. Right, multiple application contexts. This is quite interesting when you go, I suppose, scale up on the infrastructure side. It touches on to if you know Spring, you can have parent and child bean factories, and those can help you modularize your application. But you don't tend to be using bean factory types in your application. You probably run the events and the message resources that go with the application. So most people end up using application context from, for example, Spring and see a web application context from the else. So you probably already know that application context context files can be wildcarded, so you can be researching for as many application contexts that you specify, and all of them you find in a particular folder. Problem is when you start to use JMS and EJBs. Spring managed EJBs. So Spring managed EJBs are basically EJB2 beans, version 2 beans that are being gutted and stripped out, and instead of replacing them with a delegate, it's actually your POJO object. So they're just all your EJB message and session stateless and stateful session beans are very narrow. Very thin, calls to a delegate project. It will make sense as I get on. So what you normally have, what happens in the Spring Managed EJB, if you're looking at books, particularly Crow, Spring, Rob Haller, give an example where an application context is specified in part of the deployment descriptor, and the problem is here if you use the preview feature of the application server, for example, a message tree driven beam that takes information from point to point queue, and you want really fast vertical scaling, which JMS gives you for free. you say, I have a message to you, and have 100 MEBs. There's a message coming through, the application server says, right, this particular trade, I'm going to set this MDB to take that, consume that message. Now, the problem with that, if you put that into a stream managed EJB or MDB, in the traditional way, you end up with 100 application contexts, which is perhaps not a good idea. So you can use something called the context simple factory allocator. And the problem with that is, how do you define which mean first nodes? So you need to go into your application server manual for BEA web logic. There's such a thing called an application lifecycle context listener, which you can put into a BEA web logic context file. These require deployment descriptors again. Or in IBM WebSphere, you can do something called start IBM, which is basically an EJB. And this is it, startup EJB for WebSphere. Defined thing which points to, which generally says what my master application context is. I need to give it a key. The key's a big clue, FI trader. Okay, so now I guess it starts to make sense doing it in master application context. What we're using, is application context, which actually creates another context. And we're given it the ID of FI trader, which is the key. The nice key trick is that we can define, I'm using constructive injection here, to create these references to other application contexts or bin factories somewhere else in the system. So is that making sense? With that, you can get some kind of modularization. You can put all your DAOs in one context or service beams. Might be good idea. Yeah, if you were my team, and I said, Marco's left again, and I said filter work something for me, but he's got something checked out. Okay, very good. So, I will explain this. And the fact that it consumes memory and EJB instances. So what we need to do is arrange for MDBs to receive the master application context. And this is our class. This is not an MDB. This is just an example. I've got something here. This is the EJB implementation, which you can use Springs. Some abstract state of session being here. We need to get a B name. So here we've got a delegate, which is defined, well, spring will inject. This, I guess, will get a bit more different. This is JDK 4.2 code. Of course, it might be different now with annotations now. Something inject. Okay, so do the exact same thing again. Might be a good idea to use enumerations here. Stick that in a bin contents file somewhere in the system so that you send the managing data to that. And then string, this abstract state session requires you to define your delegate somewhere and put that into a client area or protected area. Have the bin factory passing. So, right. So here, okay, we've got the same thing here. Surprisingly enough, if I've got a string being defined in my service bin, because I've cleared it as part of the master application context, I'll be able to find it also all the beans and access them by the time I get into the CJB. So I can get beans created in other contexts, but by the time I execute this, it might be some other bean I might need to fully instantiate myself. Here, also what you could do is, I suppose you EJB and environment to I'm trying not to use the abbreviation to be another way of configuring it through applications that come through what that JMSQ was. Right, test-driven development. I'm not going to consider EasyMock here. EasyMock is definitely a good framework to use. For programming interfaces, what you want to do, it really helps you set up mocks of those interfaces. That would be useful. An EasyMock generally has three states. It has a setup state, a record state, a play state, and a verify state. And generally, you use that, create mocks, and then eventually set the mock with your entities, done with the main objects, run a unit test, and verify that everything's been called. Look at the EasyMock API and examples for more information. Okay, one of the things, Spring framework that is really useful is Abstract Spring Database Test Case. What that does is that you have a perhaps you have a unit test that works with a database, and you want to use records into the database, and test with DLs and entities. Spring will, in that test case, will launch your test method, but also black context around it. Things at the end of the test will never get propagated into the database. So no matter how your test runs, with a normal termination, good or abnormal termination, if there's an exception, information gets run back. Very useful for testing DLLs and service fields. Okay. Okay, IDE stuff. Now, Maven and Spring Framework Annotated is an interesting bag of tricks. I found it pretty hard to do. To get my head around it, because you have 20 different Maven projects and 5 other guys working on the same project, then you always have to update the repository all the time. It feels like, because you can't actually, because Maven turns everything on its head. So you get your dependencies from the repository, if you look at it on the dot class path. Well, you'll find links going back to the repository. So you'll always find that you are hitting F5 to update your all the project. You find something that doesn't work. Like you forgot to change the interface and the implementation, the core support of the project. But now we need an EPOB to run depending on that. The main object and the data assets object, which now has a new method. I didn't install it in the Maven repository during Maven install. So now I run a new test and it didn't quite work. I wonder why. One word of advice, I use filtered resources in Maven to actually do some work. Found that it was very unhelpful with the Eclipse IDE. Because Eclipse IDE transfers the resource in the class path, and sometimes you need instrumented resources. So I use profiles instead to generate. I made them profiles to generate dependencies actually. Configure there for production, UAT, QA. Right. Oh, if you're programming with Java 5 and make good use of collections and generics. I'm just going to show you a generic DAO, which I've been using.
Thanks. Okay, try.
Thanks for coming. And essentially, I've got a DAO which takes a type, E, and a type. The PK is the primary key object, which has to be serialized, of course, what makes it an integer, a back number. I've got all my methods here that I typically use in the DAR. You see the web client stuff attached there to being fine, my ID. Okay, so now let's see the abstract representation of that. Same thing here, it's giving us the DIO, the type, the primary key. This type here is interesting, as Java generics doesn't have it pass. It does strips away the information. So you can't get the runtime type. So that might be useful for logging. So that's why I supplied the instructor. So if you're doing log for JS, it's quite simple. Of course, you make your class, subclass, to hibernate their code support object. Just create a template and save the object, and that will get your objects into the database. And here's a simple find out key thing. Imagine if that was an integer, an object, that would get your information back. Of course, there's a missing suppressed formula here in this class. The typical thing to do here then is to actually use it. I'm supplying my type, which is something for looking up, reverse looking up my IP addresses. I'm supplying my class here, adding various benefit of that. Yes, that you can simply extend this to name print using that sort of pattern. You get the type safe for the connections as well. Use it for the new Java 5 formula. Very nice feature as I'm discovering. I've been missing the thing. First been enjoying it, most other people will enjoy it. But hopefully the new investment banks with big budgets, they probably need to get Redis Logic Service 5 or start to use JS. So, this is so I hope I covered Spring 2.1, giving you insights into where we are. We missed out on the discussion, perhaps some of it just time. If you don't get together, hopefully get nice TI examples I've been running. Reference to other competing frameworks like Ruby Juice. I've talked about the sharing application contexts. How you can roll out the modularized utility. Testing, of course, the generic data assets. That's all I have time for. Thank you very much. Questions? Or should we test this?